Bioethics Lecture Series, soon to be the Franciscan Missionaries of Our Lady University's Bioethics Lecture Series, or MOLUBUS for short. My name is Dr. John Miner, and I'm an assistant professor of theology here, and I specialize in moral theology and ethics. So that's part of my my drive to start this lecture series was to see our Catholic identity combined more fully and explicitly with our healthcare emphasis, and to serve both the college and the surrounding community and health system. So again, the lecture series is dedicated to increasing knowledge and awareness of bioethical issues among students, faculty, and medical professionals in the tri-community area, as well as the knowledge of the cogency of Catholic positions on those self-same bioethical issues. So we'll have lectures twice a year, one in the fall, one in the spring. This lecture and the lecture in the spring are being sponsored by Campus Ministry, so fully funded by Campus Ministry. And that is why you see a donations thing in the back, because our wonderful campus minister, Tammy Padrine, is sponsoring this. And there you go. So if you'd like, to support future lectures, that's how you can do it. So we have an upcoming lecture. I'll tell you a little bit about the spring since I have you here. And since I'm a professor, I love captive audiences. I just say whatever I want and you can't go anywhere. We have an upcoming lecture in the spring on March 23rd, and that will be Dr. Maureen Condon, who's an accomplished researcher and associate professor of neurobiology at the University of Utah. And she's going to be coming to speak and present on when human life begins according to science. It's a topic for which she's pretty well known. Okay, that's another day though. Today we have an equally exciting presentation. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speaker. Father William Blazek hails from Chicago. And so congratulations on the... I'm a St. Louis native myself, so a begrudging congratulations. After completing his bachelor's degree at Marquette, he served 5 years in the 101st Airborne Division as an infantry officer and deployed to Saudi Arabia and Iraq in the 1991 Gulf War. After this service, Father Blazek earned his Doctor of Medicine degree from Rush Medical and entered the Society of Jesus in 2001, immediately following his residency. Since completing the novitiate, he's enjoyed actively sharing the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius through the giving of retreats, spiritual direction, workshops, other presentations. He completed a master's degree in healthcare ethics at Loyola University in Chicago, and was then assigned to teach at Georgetown as an assistant professor of medicine. While he was in DC, I assume, he served as an advisor to the US Secretary of Defense on the Defense Health Board, which is a federal advisory panel addressing matters pertaining to the military health system. So Father Blazek studied theology also at Boston College and was ordained to the priesthood in 2012. He was appointed in August 2013 as a director of the Integras Institute for Ethics at the Blessed John Paul II Newman Center at the University of Illinois, Chicago. Yeah. His most recent assignment is as a retreat director at the Manresa Jesuit House of Retreats in Convent, Louisiana. And we are honored to have Father come and speak tonight to us about faith, science, and medicine, unraveling the myth of conflict. So help me welcome Father Blazek.
Well, I cannot tell you how glad I am to be here. I've been a patient here at Our Lady of the Lake. I had some vestibular problems, so I had a good experience, but I really wanted to get to know the community of providers and students. You know, I drive by frequently on I-10, and so now I'm so pleased to get in the door and meet some flesh and blood people involved at OLOL. As it was said, I'm from Chicago. Now that I've been down here a year, I tell the retreatants down at Manresa, thank you for rescuing me from Chicago. I'm down on the Gulf Coast now. I also really do want to thank, now a friend and colleague, Professor Meinert, who invited me here. And what a wonderful show up. I worked at a Newman Center in Chicago, as we say, it's the St. John Paul II Center now. And, it's always inspiring to see people take extra time at the end of their day to come and engage the issues of the day. So just thank you to the system, to the college and campus ministry for having me here. Take-home message of this is fairly straightforward and perhaps no surprise to you, is that expressions of faith are supremely compatible with the delivery of healthcare. No surprise here at a Catholic medical center. But this is an image of now Saint Mother Teresa delivering healthcare, right? I think in the high-tech world, we can think delivering healthcare is always cardiac catheterizations, MRIs, being in the unit. But the delivery of healthcare is broad and wide, as we know, and her faith is a great example to us to deliver healthcare with love, right? I think what I can offer for you this evening is a physician's read on this. You know, this is interdisciplinary, physician-priest, and also a Jesuit read, an Ignatian read. I'm a member of the Society of Jesus, and that either evokes instant loyalty or a stiff wall. You know, I'll take credit for everything good the society has done, and I will distance myself from anything that the brethren have done that may have raised your eyebrows. So here's a little outline for you. We're going to have some introductory comments, which we're doing now. I'll talk a little bit, I think, about the state of the problem in the world today about philosophy and medicine in general. And I'll talk about a Catholic vision of faith and reason, and thus faith and science. And we'll talk about some common critiques of a faith-based worldview, maybe particularly as it relates to medicine, but also in general. And then I'll try to give you some tools, if you are a person of faith, to respond to those critiques, right? And close just with a few ideas of hope that I have found in my time on different medical centers, medical universities, and teaching institutions. Presuppositions. It's always important to talk about our presuppositions. I think a presupposition I will bring to this is that everyone wants to be happy, right? And those of you who've had a little philosophy will recognize this Greek term eudaimonia. Eudaimonia. And what does that mean? The rich, fulfilling life. The rich and fulfilling life is what we are looking for. And I was Googling this around, and what do I find? It ends up that eudaimonia is actually a popular tattoo. Go figure. Greek word, right? Now, maybe some of the younger people have a eudaimonia tattoo. You can show us after the talk. Most of the older ones, we probably don't have that yet. Another presupposition goes all the way back to Aristotle, right? The first sentence of his metaphysics is that we desire to know. We desire to know. And what do we want to know? We want to know the truth, right? We don't want to know lies. We don't want to know distortions. We want to know material that is useful and helpful to us in seeking our happiness, right? So we do desire to know. I bring also one other presupposition before we dive into the material. These are some Ignatian values. St. Ignatius was big on dialogue and inquiry and on humility, right? On humility. And I think all the great philosophers and theologians know the limits of their knowledge. He sent some theologians to the Council of Trent, you know, 500 years ago, big council in the church looking at the Reformation. And he counseled them that they be modest in presenting their opinions, listen with respect to the viewpoints of others, and always review and consider both sides of a disputed point. And then this, to show deference for the judgment better than their own. To show deference to the judgment better than their own. And that's sort of a, we call it epistemic humility. That we're not so certain that we're not willing to be taught, that we're unteachable. If somebody knows a correct opinion and we're holding an incorrect opinion, we should thank them for teaching us, right? We should thank them for teaching us. Okay, so what is one of the big issues, I think, the state of the problem goes back to what John Paul II, now St. John Paul, identified when he was looking at questions about truth and faith and reason, and that is the distorted understanding of human reason that can be operative in the broad world today, but also then, of course, in the application of healthcare. And what St. John Paul said is, giving ourselves over to relativism and skepticism, we go off in search of an illusory freedom apart from truth itself. So those of you who have circulated on other university campuses will be well familiar with the deep skepticism towards certain kinds of knowledge that is operative in what they call the academy, right? Just intelligentsia. This doubt that we can know any true moral good, that we can know anything about the nature of the human person with any certainty or clarity. And so when our freedom becomes untethered from truth, that is where things can run amok in culture and in society, and then in the application of your given fields, right? Whether it be as a radiology tech, whether it be in the lab, those of you who are studying to be lab technicians, we have clinicians here, we have administrators, every walk of life, this untethering of freedom from truth was a fundamental issue. That's why he addressed it so early in his papacy. I like what Chesterton said about this. He said, we are creating a race too mentally modest to believe even in the multiplication table. And some will dispute this. We have the ability to know, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. I know we have at least one mathematics professor here. I saw it on Thursday. I don't know if he holds this to be true or not. So what about on the healthcare scene, right? Well, this epistemic, meaning not believing that we have knowledge, the epistemology is, right, the philosophy of knowing, the philosophy of knowledge, with this uncertainty, this skepticism about the nature of the human person, the nature of the universe, the nature of the beginning of life, it ties right into the big questions about intrinsic evil in the world today. So is abortion intrinsically disordered or not? If you think you can't know that, then you can't believe that it is. So abortion one. How about euthanasia and, say, the execution of prisoners, right? So that syringe representing that. Or the transgender question, right? So can we transform a male into a female at the very essence of their being by appending breast implants and genitourinary surgery and facial transformation surgery? And this this question about uncertainty ties certainly to these kinds of issues. And then, aside from questions of intrinsic evil, there's just these prudential judgments that we have to make. And in the election, we all had to make these sort of judgments about, say, the cost of health care, what amount of money we will spend on the delivery of health care and service to the poor. I just came from Caracas, Venezuela. I do not fly there often, but I just happened to have the graced opportunity to give a retreat down there. And, you know, not 500 meters, well, not 3 miles, certainly, from a world-class airport. Tommy Hilfiger, Sunglasses Hut, equivalent of Pizza Hut, like a mall, right? Duty-free, Crown Royal Liquor. I'm sure it was not a 7-minute drive to where people were living like what you see, you know, in ads for trying to raise money for the poor in third world countries. And I think our epistemic uncertainty relates to those kinds of policy questions that the nation wrestles with. How do we deal with global issue tuberculosis? Can these sweet little sisters choose the kind of health care that they deliver to, or choose the kind of insurance that they provide for their employees? Or can Our Lady of the Lake, for that matter? So let's pause here. I gave you all a handout, and I'd like you to break either into twos and threes and just ask yourself, if, you know, if you're not already a professional in healthcare or if you're related to one, you can fill in whatever job there. You can look at what your hopes and desires were, but I'd like you to think about whether your faith has anything to do with these questions, and this question of whether faith is an obstacle somehow to your professional advancement, particularly in a scientific field. So just take a minute to think about it, and then you're going to discuss it. On, we'll just take 5 minutes to do this in little twos and threes. It's one of those awkward exercises. That's why these chairs turn.
Well, that's actually my second. I'm a consultant.
Yeah.
some more chances to interact later in the talk. So it seems there's a lively energy. All right, we talked a little bit just, I think, about this fundamental problem of skepticism. And then I wanted to say something about the Catholic vision of faith and reason, right? So Catholicism as a faith has a lot of both ands, right? And you probably have heard that. So Jesus, in our faith, both God and human, right? The Virgin Mary, both mother and virgin. But also at a doctrinal level, right, we have revelation in the scriptures and tradition, right? One of the other big both ands is faith and reason, which relates to that question about revelation and the tradition. And what St. John Paul said in his encyclical on faith and reason was that faith and reason are like two wings in which the human spirit rises to the contemplation of truth, right? That goes back to what I said about the desire to know and the ability to know truth and the existence of the truth, right? So we are contemplating the truth, and that God has placed on the human heart a desire to know the truth. Go right back to what I said about Aristotle, we desire to know. So that by knowing and loving God, men and women may come to the fullness of truth about themselves, right? And this is that idea from St. Irenaeus, you know, the fullness of God is the human person truly alive, right? The human person truly alive. We come to know about God in knowing ourselves, and in knowing about ourselves, we come to know God. In order for us to use our reason, we have to accept that we can know things through our reason. And there's some fundamental principles that are applicable here, that there is a principle of non-contradiction, that can be known and understood, that two opposites cannot simultaneously be true, right? This laser pointer cannot be gray and black at the same time, right? Or, you know, something cannot be a goat and a giraffe at the same time. Causality. We use the principle of causality all the time and often in medicine and in healthcare. You know, if you're going to give a certain medicine that blocks a certain receptor, whatever it might be, we believe that a sequence of events will be set into motion with a predictable outcome, with a reasonably predictable outcome. I mean, this goes back to shooting billiard balls. If you hit a billiard ball on such and such an angle, it will go off on such and such an angle. Now, causality, cause and effect, has been disputed philosophically, but in everyday life, we do not act as if we do not understand cause and effect, right? All of the interventions that we make depend on the idea of cause and effect. We believe that we are free. There's a big movement in the world about predestination in terms of genetically or behaviorally sort of being pre-programmed. But experience teaches us that we are free agents and that freedom is an important part of our moral responsibility. And then lastly, just the intelligibility of creation. Can we know something about creation? And if you're a dentist, we believe that you can know something about dental materials, right? That this kind of enamel or this kind of synthetic enamel will behave in such and such a way, and we can know that and understand it. Or if you're using agents and reagents in a lab, that they will interact in such and such a way, and that is intelligible. Or that human development is intelligible and the nature of our being. So creation is knowable and intelligible is a fundamental understanding of the way we see the world. Does anybody know what the state flower of Louisiana is?
Magnolia.
That's the magnolia. This has nothing whatsoever to do with my talk. It's that's your one dose of beauty during this talk. And it's very nice. If that's a Catholic vision of faith and reason, what are some of the critiques of faith that are, you know, we talked about this kind of incompatibility of faith and reason, I think thus of faith and science. What are some of the common critiques leveled at this worldview? One is that it's unprofessional, right? Another is that God does not exist, so faith doesn't make any sense. There's this concept of the triumph of the empirical sciences over any other kind of knowledge, that the Bible itself is incoherent and self-refuting, and then there's the problem of evil. So we're going to look at each of these in a little detail, and then we're going to look at some of the responses to those in a bit of detail. So the flying spaghetti monster, right? How many of you are familiar with the flying spaghetti monster? If you go online and look around at atheism or new atheism, you'll see this up there. And I had a paper, not a paper, but an article published in a pretty reasonable spiritual journal not too many years ago. And the critique wasn't that the flying spaghetti monster was inspiring. It was that my invisible pink rabbit friend was what I believed in. That you could as easily believe in a pink invisible rabbit or this flying spaghetti monster. And some of you may have seen, you know, the idea of the spaghetti monster is the religion of Pastafarianism, right? And this is all over the web. It's not, I'm not making this up to you. You'll see this on the back of cars instead of a fish or the Darwin sign. You'll see the flying spaghetti monster thing on the back of people's car. And I think very offensively, you'll see statements like this. You know, he boiled for our sins. And we'll talk a little bit about some of the problems with that critique. The other critique about believing in God is actually not that sophisticated, and it's sort of a duh, you know, like, you are an idiot, like, you know, the Three Stooges, and we'll talk about that too. I think more subtle and more applicable in the world you're moving in is this ideas about scientism that, that empirical science is the only source of useful knowledge, and or maybe perhaps logic, and that's why I put Mr. Spock in there, and also the incoherency of the Bible as a source of knowledge. You'll see critiques that the church is sort of anti-freedom, religion is anti-freedom, anti-woman, religion as a source of evil, and the problem of evil in general. Where does evil come from in the world? We look at like Nazi medical experiments or like Tuskegee, right? You know, so the syphilis experiments at Tuskegee in the 1930s, exploitative. And then there's other kinds of evil, right? Cancer, tsunamis, death itself. So before I dig in on all of those, I want you to turn to each other again and take a look at either in your education or your practice, have you faced a serious dilemma between choosing between faith and science? Consider how you might have resolved that specific episode, and if it, you know, probably happened somewhere in the past, would you maybe proceed differently today? And just discuss that for a few minutes amongst yourself as well. I believe it is. Something about professionalism itself, right? I like to go to the dictionary. I'm kind of a word person. Profession comes from this word in Latin, professio, right? To declare. And if you look in Webster, that could be the act of taking vows in a religious community. So that's the first definition. I'm a Jesuit. I took vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. And we take a vow of availability for mission. But another thing is to openly declare or publicly claim a belief or a faith, an avowed religious faith. So if you are, say, a Catholic who goes to Mass on Sundays, we profess our faith together in the creed, right? And other religions have these sorts of professions, declarations of what it is they believe. It's only in the fourth definition that we come to how medicine or law or other technical professions would be defined calling, requiring specialized knowledge and often long and intensive academic preparation, right? So to work in any of the health sciences usually takes several years of study, whether it's as a technician, an assistant, a therapist, a dentist, a physician, or to be a professor, somebody who professes knowledge. And I often think when you look at these kinds of definitions, they can be exclusive, but often there's a close overlap. That's why we use the same word. So the idea that professing a faith and having a career that requires specialized knowledge and long and intensive academic preparation are somehow mutually exclusive does not make any sense. We have a much more inclusive, it's the both and, that I can both have technical training and profess my faith. You know, this idea that God is the equivalent of a flying spaghetti monster and makes as much sense as that is what they call, you know, a reductio ad absurdum. So if somebody ever says to you, you know, God makes as much sense as a big pink bunny, you can say, that's reductio ad absurdum, you know, and you'll impress the heck out of them. But it just means to reduce something to the absurd. It's actually to reduce it to the insulting. You know, I'm a big fan of Bishop Robert Barron, and a lot of this talk, you know, could almost be out of his mouth. If you go to the Word on Fire website, he talks about these things at length in his podcasts and critiques of what he calls the YouTube heresies, the heresies that are proposed on YouTube. We don't believe that God is a man up in space. You know, the Russian saint Yuri Gagarin, the first person to travel up into space to look for God and to look for evidence of God. God isn't up here in the sky. Well, we don't believe that God is somewhere up above the stratosphere, literally. We have God who is ipsum esse, right? He's being itself, the pure act. The being upon, he has no contingency on any other being. I'm contingent on my mother. I'm contingent on eating. I'm contingent on being able to breathe. God, not contingent. God, something nothing greater than which can be imagined, right? These are not a man in the sky. And there's any number of philosophical proofs of God's existence that, if you've never familiarized yourself with them, Google them. St. Anselm, St. Augustine, St. Thomas. Argument from motion. You know, all motion comes from somewhere. It's something has to start something in motion. And if you go all the way back in the train, God. Now that's a long way from the God of the Old Testament, that which started motion, but it's an argument for the existence of God that is different than a childhood fantasy. They're really attacking a straw man, they call it, when you just reduce God to that kind of ridiculous figure. What about you're an idiot? Well, that's what they call an ad hominem argument. It's just attacking the person rather than the idea. And you know, we can ask this question, Thomas More, St. Thomas More, the greatest legal statesman, great man of faith, great saint. He rose to be Chancellor of England and Henry VIII's right-hand man. You know, was he an idiot? How about Thomas Aquinas, who they say, you know, people, they didn't have typewriters and they couldn't dictate things in a microphone, so he would dictate to several scribes at once. If he was dictating one paragraph to him, one to her, one here, it was like somebody who could play chess with seven people at once. He's no idiot. In fact, he's so smart, I can barely read anything he writes. What about this list of Jesuit scientists just from the 20th century? And this is just Jesuit scientists, right? People of faith who were paleontologists, zoologists, archaeologists, with integrated faith. You think about Gregor Mendel, right? From which our whole genetics at least sprang, a monk, right? A religious brother in a monastery, and many others beside, right? So don't let them force that kind of argument and constraint upon you, I think. What about scientism, which is probably one of the ones that you most reasonably come upon in healthcare, which is that, you know, Scientific empirical knowledge as we understand it today is the only real source of knowledge that we're going to allow in the clinical workplace. And I think that is a pretty common ideal. If you saw this movie, The Martian, anybody see The Martian?
Yeah.
You know, so this guy is marooned on Mars through a sequence of events, and he uses science to use the tools at hand to ultimate, I don't want to ruin the movie for you, but it doesn't have a sad ending. It has a happy ending. But it's through the use of science and scientific analysis that he uses all these tools that he does have on Mars through the space program to ultimately get rescued. But there's a scene where they're trying to decide whether to launch a Chinese rocket in the rescue efforts for him. And some scientists are talking to each other, and they say very seriously, "We will have to keep this conversation between scientists. It's too important for politicians or for economists or whoever." I mean, and this is a multifactorial decision. It's a political decision whether to ask China if we can use one of their rockets. It's an economic decision. Can we afford to launch a rocket? It's a philosophical, there's some ethical questions of putting other people's lives at risk. It's not a purely scientific question. But that attitude pervades that movie, and I think it pervades our culture in many ways. The other is that, you know, well, we can only live by logic, and that's why I put Mr. Spock. I could never do that. I can only do the two. You know, Spock wasn't human, right? I mean, he had no emotions, and he lived only by logic. That's not how human beings live. That's outside our nature. And so we can't live purely by logic or reason. There are limits on the scientific method, right? It's great at answering how should we live, not so good at should we, you know, like the creation of atomic weapons or hydrogen weapons. Well, it has its role, it has its place, it accomplished certain things, but, you know, the scientists who were creating those created them, you know, they didn't create them ex nihilo, but they participated in developing those. The question of whether to apply them is an ethical question. It's outside the science of high-energy physics, say. There are limits, as each and every one of us knows, to the double-blinded, prospective, placebo-controlled trial. And we wrestle with those. You know, is it even applicable to our patients, this particular study? And you can't expect that every answer on the face of, every question on the face of the earth is going to be answered by one. There are other kinds of knowledge, right? Emotional, intuitive, we have our reason, we can think deductively, inductively. There's mathematical knowledge that is not proven in prospective trials, and I think also aesthetic knowledge. There's a beautiful passage at the end of Anna Karenina that I really like, and there's this Tolstoy-esque figure, and he's head over heels in love with Princess Kitty, right? This young, beautiful princess on the St. Petersburg scene. And they're towards the end of the book. He's married her, and they're having a happily ever after. But he liked to work with his peasant workers, the serfs, and they're out cutting hay or mowing some kind of oats or something like that. And they're talking about how to make decisions in life. And this figure says, "I believe in reason." And the serf, who's sort of a wisdom figure, and he goes, "Oh, was it by reason that you chose your wife? Was it by use of your reason that you chose your wife?" Well, no. This guy, who was a very rational guy, had other aspects to his human personality, and he chose for emotional, romantic reasons. I think about beauty and knowledge of beauty. You know, why is it that the ratio 3 to 5 or 1 to 3 is more aesthetically pleasing than 17 to 18 or something, right? We know what's beautiful when we see it. These are some beautiful students that I went to World Youth Day, and some sisters that I went with, and you know how we know their beauty is a kind of knowledge that can't be reduced, I think, to the scientific method. Shakespeare, did Shakespeare know anything about the truth? Yes, he did. And he was a Christian believer, right? What about St. Paul? Right. He knew some things about love. Which we all do, right? We all hope to know something about love. What about the Bible? So there's this critique that the Bible is full of contradiction, right? And you might run across this again in your practice or in, on a university campus. I'll just talk about one kind of thing. We'll talk about covenants, right? I think a lot of people understand the Bible only in its literal sense and maybe as restrictive. Americans tend to see law, say the Ten Commandments, as very restrictive and telling them what not to do. So it becomes something like don't park here or pay your taxes in such and such a way. But really, the moral law is could be seen much more as prescriptive and as this covenant between us and God. So it has to do with how we're seeing and understanding the Bible, not reducing it to a purely literal interpretation. This comes from Jeremiah. I know the plans I have in mind for you, plans for your welfare, not for your woe. And if you begin to understand the Bible through that hermeneutic, through that interpretive key, it takes on a whole other set of meanings, right? And so that even things like the Torah, the Ten Commandments, the first five books, the Pentateuch, say, and the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue, become a blueprint for life rather than a restriction. They become the model of our covenant. And all other really biblical questions, I think so often, and this is pointed out by many others than me, is it's often a question of genre. People will look at the Bible and say, well, it doesn't make sense. You know, we have this genealogy. Well, genealogies were intended to convey a certain kind of message when they were written 2,000 years ago. Or how about the Song of Songs? My lover is a gazelle, right? Well, if you interpret that literally, you've got problems, right? I mean, like, this is, maybe not by some standards, but like, my lover's not a gazelle. My lover's like a gazelle. So, you know, there's analog, there's analogy, and there's metaphors that are at work in the Bible. And very often, when somebody is kind of trying to mess you up biblically, they're not interpreting it in terms of the correct genre, as a poem, or as a covenant, or as a history that is not to be interpreted literally. One of the young men was saying, you know, well, if you interpret such and such a story literally as opposed to metaphorically, you come up with a whole different way of understanding the scriptures. The problem of evil is probably one of the biggest critiques levied at a faith-based worldview, right? And so how could there have been Nazis? How can there... Problems with free will we can explain through sin, but how can there be cancer? How can there be tsunamis? One of the arguments is God allows us our free will in order that we can exercise it. He won't take it away from us. Another argument would be that these evils allow for even greater and better goods, so that British imperialism in India allows for a Gandhi, or the Boer War allows for a Gandhi. Racism in America allows for Martin Luther King. I think the stronger argument about the problem of evil is that if God is omniscient and all-powerful, all-knowing, we understand as much about the mind of God, we would say, as our dog understands about us. So this is the RCA Victor dog listening to his master's voice on a gramophone. And that dog might understand as much about the gramophone or about his master who spoke into the gramophone as we understand about the mind of God. Like, we just don't get it. We don't know. So it reduces it to mystery. It might not be the greatest response, but it's a strong response. And I think in the same way as those of you who have children, you might tell your children, make the bed, and they don't want to. They understand about as much about why it's important to make a bed as we understand about how God has ordered the world. That's one analysis. Some of you who've made retreats with me, you'll know what I'm about to say. But, you know, this is the flag of the state of Louisiana. Everywhere I go, by the way, there's Manresa retreats. I could be in Chicago, right? I could be in, I was flying home from Dallas. They sit next to me on the plane or everything. So I have to be on my best behavior 24/7 everywhere I go, which is good for me. This is a flag of the great state of Louisiana, right? That's a pelican. So how many of you all know that the pelican is a Christ figure? If you do, if you know that, raise your hand, right? A few of you, many, okay, several know that. How is the pelican a Christ figure? The pelican is a Christ figure because he pecks at its chest to feed its young. That was the medieval understanding. They thought, okay, it takes its blood. And we now know that it's really regurgitating fish heads into the mouths of its young, which is much less romantic, I think, than the idea of giving it blood. But that's, you know, the blood of the Eucharist, right? That's the blood of the cross. That's the blood that pours forth from the side of Christ. So when the pelican is doing that, it was always saw as a Christic symbol. And you'll see it in different church art that way. And then I tell the retreatants, don't tell the ACLU what I just told you, because they're going to take our flag away from it. Okay, let's just take a moment to, this will be our last little private conversation with each other. Take a look at one of your heroes in the medical profession. Some of you are already talking about this. And maybe take an anecdote or some of their qualities that make them a medical hero. And tell me, you know, tell each other whether that person's a person of faith and how their faith might have informed their heroism in your eyes. I think that's an interesting exercise. So let's just take, again, we'll take 5 minutes to do that, and then we'll wrap this whole thing up. Okay? All right.
Thank you.
All right, well, if I can bring your attention back to the dais up here. I have a few thoughts about healthcare from a particularly from a Catholic perspective. And a lot of that points to treating the entire person, right? In the Jesuits, we talk about cura personalis, caring for the person. But that's clearly not just a Jesuit value. And this comes from the Catholic Bishops' Conference in their ethical and religious directives, which if you've never read them, pull them offline. They're very, very helpful in whatever walk of healthcare provision you're doing. They say this about Christ, you know, Christ as the healer. And we can all, I think, if you're a Christian, serve as a Christic healer in our encounters with patients. He, Jesus, sought their physical, mental, and spiritual healing. He came so that they might have life and have it more abundantly. Now, this is an image of the woman with the hemorrhage, right? So if you're familiar with the scriptures, the woman with the hemorrhage had suffered for many years bleeding, and because of that, you know, ritually, not morally, ritually could not participate in the cultic activities of the temple, in regular family and societal life. And it says in the scriptures that she suffered greatly at the hands of her physicians, right? Is that possible? How could it be, right? But she did. And she had spent all her money, and in that, she was broke, so she was isolated in that regard. But when Christ healed her, he allowed her both to enter back into the cultic activity of the temple, into the religious life of the community, and into regular family life. So he healed her at multiple, multiple levels. And I think as healthcare providers, again, we can get into our niche, into our little silo. So I know some here like studying to be radiology techs. Okay, well, your job is, you know, to look and take this picture. But really, if you're working clinically with patients, we all know what it's like to be treated like garbage by somebody who's too busy to take care of us at whatever level of the healthcare system, or to be treated with care, love, and respect in the way they're handling our bodies. Or if we talk, we have dentists, same way. Or in whatever kind of therapeutic role or as a practitioner with decision making. And so we all want to approach people mind, body, and spirit. That's a very much a Catholic read, I think, on healthcare. We can bring the law of love. Pope Francis has asked us, what is the law of the people of God? And if you're a believer, the law of the people of God as a Christian is, love one another as I have loved you. And we bring that goes right to Mother Teresa, you know, do these small things with great love, the small actions of love for individual people in every single facet of our day, right? And I think we can get lost in the busy clinical workplace, you know, it's like, I'm in a hurry, I'll love you later, I gotta go, you know? So don't fall into that trap, not that I ever did, right? I think another thing that we can bring to the healthcare landscape is anthropology, right? But not anthropology as it might be taught, again, say at LSU, where, okay, we're looking at the ascent of the human person through different kinds of evolution. Or if you're a sociologist today, you know, maybe you really see the devolution of the human person, right? Into Homo sapien. And, you know, the Family Guy, this is the model of who the parent is, right? You're all Simpson fans. You're allowed to laugh at that. That's barely. I looked long and hard for that slide. But here's our image of the human person, right? This is the human person fully alive, right, in God, who is made in the image and likeness of God, right? Free and able to love. And that's a whole different kind of anthropology. The splendor of truth, we go back to truth, shines forth in all the works of the Creator in a special way in the human person created in the image and likeness of God. So I like St. John Paul II. Have you picked up on that yet? He's a big hero of mine, philosophically, theologically. And that anthropology is what we bring to each of these questions in the clinical workplace. How do we treat a morula? Will I work with stem cells taken from embryonic destruction? Is it a moral evil to destroy this clump of cells? It's 16 cells, 32 cells. What about life in the womb, right? How do we treat it? What about our disabled individuals? And at the end of life, we have a gerontologist here, geriatric physician with us, and there, you know, it's all day long, the ethical challenges. And it all has to do with who and what is the human person, and can we know them? What about this? You know, I mentioned that questions about gender surgery, which are very active in the culture and the society. And, you know, if 10 years ago you would have told me that by giving me breast implants, doing some genitourinary surgery, and giving me some facial surgery, I would become a woman, you would have said, "You're nuts, Father Blazek. What are you talking about?" Now, by opening the question, you know, we probably have to have a safe space, some Play-Doh, things for people to go work with. But, like, the world has really turned upside down on this kind of issue. And the nature of the human person as man or woman intrinsically, I think we have to look at as providers. And then it'll inform how you participate or don't participate or counsel people. I just read something kind of interesting that something like Bruce Jenner's transformation probably cost something like $100,000, right? And maybe your insurance company can get it for less. $100,000. But you think about that in the face of what I showed you about Caracas, Venezuela. And you know, the fact that people are living in boxes while we're spending $100,000 on cosmetic surgery. And that's an important ethical consideration, and it ties very much to the nature of the human person and whether or not you believe we can know anything about the nature of the human person. Couple resources for you. Fides et Ratio. That's the Faith and Reason encyclical. It's on your handout. Veritatis Splendor. That's also on your handout. The Dogmatic Constitution on Divine Revelation, I think, is very helpful about the relationship between revelation and tradition. But also, if you get a Catholic study Bible in the older editions, there's usually some very good articles about scriptural interpretation at the beginning of those. And then I'm big on Bishop Robert Barron. As I say, a lot of this talk, if you listen to his podcasts, if you listen to his sermons or read some of his articles up on the Word on Fire website, you'll hear his voice in a lot of what I say, certainly. And he's a marvelous, marvelous resource. A few things of hope. I've been working on university campuses for several years, and I think sometimes just proposing that there is truth can really get the gears turning in people's minds. Jesus came as witness to truth. You know, he says, "This I was born, this I came into the world, to give testimony to the truth." And I think sometimes I'd be talking with groups of students or with providers, and I'd say, well, they'd say, "Why are you here?" And I'd say, "I am here to give testimony to the truth." Sometimes I would say, "I am here to give witness that God exists." Those are very fundamental statements, but they can get people thinking. And so that's a sign of hope to me, that people are going to engage that idea. The other is this idea, and I would give this particularly to the students when I was teaching in the East for a little while, and at one of our health schools, it has a healthcare school. And I would say, you know, authentic freedom itself is exercised in the light of truth. Authentic freedom is exercised in the light of truth. And I think proposing that there are inauthentic freedoms and authentic freedoms was a novel concept to some of the students. They hadn't had a time to think about this, or they hadn't been pushed on it. We get a technical education, scientific education, not a lot of ethical training sometimes in some of the undergrad preps that go into a healthcare education. This image of truth is by Annabelle Carracci, and in it, you know, truth is, she's fairly nude, as you can see here, and but she's veiled. There's a sort of a translucent veil, and I think that speaks a lot about the nature of truth. Truth should be naked, see, unhidden, and with nothing obstructing the way we understand it. Yet the veil represents, you know, we never get exactly a complete, perfect vision because of our human finitude. And so we have to be careful to understand how truth might be veiled or how our own lenses are distorting the truth. I think the truth exists. It can be known. Faith and reason are not mutually exclusive, but they are complementary, right? They are complementary to each other. And if someone will not tolerate your believing that, you just say, hey, tolerate this. You know, we're into tolerance, right? Tolerate that. Faith is supremely compatible with the delivery of healthcare. Here we have a beautiful image of Mother Teresa, again, caring for a sick person. For those of you who want to join me in a closing prayer, we'll say, glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, thank you for coming. We have time for some Q&A, or if you want to just do it one-on-one, I'm happy.
I think we may just do it one-on-one. We really need all of your help to eat the amount of food we have.
We have food,
water, other things. So please help me in thanking Father Blazek. If you have questions for him, please ask them individually while we enjoy it.
Thank you.